you know, I was not involved, but did I cause the accident? Yeah, I did, I think. Welcome back to Heroes Next Door. Thank you all for watching. Do us a favor, hit that subscribe, hit that notification so I can keep bringing you more content. Today I was at work and I was doing my Con Ed and I was doing my EVOC course for my Con Ed, and it got me thinking about the ambulance crashes that I've either witnessed, been part of, or heard of over my career. And, you know, we do a lot of reviews of, you know, the Chicago Fire, the 911s, you know, all those kind of shows. And every show that I've seen so far has had an ambulance crash at one point or another. People are going to ask, is that reality? And yes, it is. We are going to crash. The fact of the matter is there are over 6,500 crashes per year. Within those crashes, 35% of those have a serious injury or a fatality during it. So we really need to pay attention to not only the way we drive and the safety features that the ambulances have, but how these are built and what are involved in, you know, keeping us safe. We have a couple videos out there that show some ambulances, right? We have Keystone, they have a BLS ambulance, but it's an F, I think 550 or 450, pretty large ambulance. You've also seen one at Minquist that is an F550, that's an extended cab, another fairly large ambulance. Some of you across the pond are going, wait, our ambulances aren't that big. We use maybe a Sprinter kind of van. There are multiple types of ambulances out there, and each one of them have their pros and their cons. But everything that has to be done with these ambulances is all designed for safety. So years ago, there was an incident where I was involved in an accident. I wasn't the driver, I was the passenger. We were responding to a call in a chase car type vehicle. For us, it was actually an old Chevy Lumina. And what happened is we came up on a large traffic jam going our direction. So we had the lights and sirens on and they yielded the right of way, but we had to cross the double yellow and travel down opposite way of traffic. Up ahead of us was the intersection and those people were giving us the right of way. They stopped. We clearly had a green light going our way, but everybody was stopped. We thought things were going well. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, in the line that was going with us, this young girl decided to turn left in front of us because there was a parking spot. She either was on her phone or she was listening to the radio, didn't hear our sirens. Whatever the fact was, you know, we're traveling in the wrong lane, but yet she turned in front of us and we hit her pretty hard. Fortunately, it was behind her driver, so she wasn't hurt real bad. We weren't hurt real bad, but it was an accident that, you know, we look back at, could it have been avoided? Probably not. What safety equipment did we have? At the time, I was wearing my seatbelt. This old Chevy Lumina didn't have a passenger side airbag at the time, only had the driver's side. That went off. The lady's car that we hit also has had some airbags, but it didn't have the side airbags. This is a couple years back. So it got me really thinking, are these ambulances that we ride in the best for our service? Is there a way that we can improve? The NFPA, which is the National Fire Protection Association, has implemented some rules, which is 1917, the standard for automotive ambulances, and that was published back in 2012. Before that, there is the KKK A1822-F standards, which helped us really start to get a understanding of what ambulances go through during crashes. There's a really good video out there that shows a side impact. If you search the internet or YouTube, you're gonna see some of these crashes that are pretty significant. We understand as providers that it is gonna be a risk to ride in an ambulance. We have things such as opticoms with changed lights from red to green going our direction. The question is, are those appropriate? Are they useful or are they more harmful? The other question that's been raised over the years is, should we be doing lights and sirens going to the hospital? Should we be doing lights and sirens, even making a call, you know, on the original 911 call? And this is something that you need to debate with your company, with your community to determine yes or no, is this inappropriate? Where I'm coming from, and just in my experience, we have the ability to do lights and sirens to a hospital and lights and sirens to a 911. I personally, depending on the call, we get the information out there. If it's a chest pain, cardiac arrest, something like that, we're going lights and sirens to that call. If it's dispatched as a BLS call, which is a basically fall down, go boom, maybe a sick person or something like that, we choose not to go lights and sirens to those calls because of the risk factors that are involved. Now, once I get there, and even during a cardiac arrest, these serious calls, I have to make a determination to my driver whether we're going to go lights or sirens to the hospital. there's only really two circumstances that I go lights and sirens to a hospital. One is an active MI, whether that's from a cardiac arrest and we got them back and they have ROSC and we need to get them to a cath lab because I can't do that in the field. Or two, whether it's an active stroke. Now, even with the active strokes, you're going to see pretty soon, we're going down to Capital Health out of New Jersey, and they have a stroke team that brings a mobile CT. So even that may be going away if we use those kind of vehicles. But currently, I don't have that. So I'm going to go lights and sirens to a hospital because of a stroke, active heart attack, return of ROSC. Those kind of incidences, I'm going to go lights and sirens. If you're sick, I don't necessarily go lights and sirens to a hospital. I have the ability to manage you until we can get there. So I can put the IVs in, I can give the medications, I can speed up your heart, I can slow down your heart. You know, the technology that we have just in treating of patients really has also changed what we have for ambulances and what we should be doing. There's some pretty spectacular accidents that are out there. I remember an incident that I was personally involved in, but it wasn't my ambulance. And I'm giving you an example of using our opticoms, meaning we're changing the light green our direction. We were heading down the road, and it was kind of heavy traffic. I had seen at least two cycles of lights before we got down the road to that intersection. So as I'm pulling through the intersection, we get the green light. But it had just changed going the other direction. So as I pull through, there's another car that started pulling out across from us. I was able to kind of swerve away from it. But what happened is I didn't hit that person, but the person coming my opposite direction, they ended up getting a green light. They hit that person. So, you know, I was not involved, but did I cause the accident? Yeah, I did, I think, you know, because we specifically changed a light. We changed the direction of traffic. And, you know, the one thing that you're going to see a lot of us do as drivers of ambulances and emergency vehicles, police cars or anything like that, we yell at traffic all the time because nobody knows what to do. You're supposed to do what? Slow down, pull to the right for sirens and lights, right? Nobody does that. I had one incident. I am going down an expressway, so I'm going pretty good. I'm doing probably 75, 80 miles an hour, and I come up across this car in the fast lane, and instead of slowing down or pulling to the right for me, they stop just like that. I jammed on my brakes. I almost rear-ended them. Fortunately, I kind of saw it happening, but they don't know what's going on. They panic when they see lights and sirens behind them. So we as EMS providers have to pay attention to what we're doing. Unfortunately, there are things that we, you know, try to fix. And, you know, the size of the ambulance makes a difference. We have a turnpike, which is a pretty large expressway. Years ago, there was an incident where one of my friends was hit on the expressway, on the turnpike. They had pulled off the side of traffic. They had blocked it with their ambulance. They were doing what was quote unquote safe for the time, but a semi tractor trailer come up over the hill, didn't see him, skidded and wiped out the whole scene. Very tragic. You know, the question at that moment in time, since that moment in time for us, they ended up getting very large ambulances to go on the turnpike. In some of the smaller cities, those large ambulances, maybe like the Freightliners or the Pierces or something like that, may not be efficient to fit down some of the smaller streets or the one-way streets in a smaller city or a college town, so you have to go with a smaller ambulance. The other thing is that I want to talk about is every ambulance nowadays meets these standards. They have the seat belts. Maybe they have a five-point harness. They have a five-point harness for your patient. They have, you know, airbags. They have to meet standards of rollover so the box doesn't all fall apart. But we all do it, and I'm guilty of it myself. There are times when I'm working in the back of the ambulance where I get up, I unbuckle, or sometimes I don't even buckle because I'm working on a patient, and I gotta go to my monitor across the, or then I gotta go to my IV drawer, or then I gotta go get another bag for here for my glucometer. You know, they set it up for drawers, but nothing's always right at your fingertips, especially when you're traveling down the road. So it makes me think, is there a way or is there an ambulance out there that can make this easier for us? So I'm going to throw a question out to you guys. Put it in the comments below. What kind of ambulances do you guys drive? What kind of safety features do you like? And what kind of safety features don't you like? Personally, some of these seat belts that they have on the side sitting ambulance when I'm in the action seat, I can't get to my patient. It really locks me in. I hit a bump or I hit something like that, and I can't physically get to my patient, so I have to unbuckle. Yes, the ambulance has the safety features, but are we using them? I want to know what you guys have. Put it in the comments below and let me know. So thank you for watching. This is Heroes Next Door. Do us a favor, hit that subscribe, hit that notification.